Good evening, I'm Christian Esguera, and welcome to this episode of After the Fact, where we get to see things more clearly, where we get a better sense of the truth. Let's begin by dissecting the news. Earlier today, Vice President Leni Robredo announced her senatorial ticket in next year's presidential election. It's a mix of familiar names, 5 guest candidates included, some of whom may not necessarily be considered quote-unquote opposition. But Robredo's campaign team believes it represents a broad coalition, which of course is important in uniting opposition forces for 2022. But the list also became prominent for a name that's missing. Former Bayan Muna Congressman Eric Colmenares' Makabayan Bloc is very much part of the Isambayan process, which endorsed and pushed for Robredo's candidacy. But why was his name left out? Was it because until now, the Makabayan Bloc has yet to decide whether to support Robredo for president? Now, be part of our discussion. Send us your questions and comments on our YouTube live chat or tweet us using the hashtag ANCAfterTheFact. Joining us tonight is Attorney Barry Gutierrez, his Vice President Leni Robredo's spokesman. Good evening, sir, and thank you for joining us again on the program.
Good evening, Christian, and always happy to be here.
Okay, the people that were included so far in the senatorial ticket of Vice President Leni Robredo, this has been described as a broad coalition, basically representative of that broad coalition. But talk to us first about the process. How exactly were these people picked to be included in her ticket?
Well, there were a lot of conversations going on between the team of VP Leni, led, as she revealed earlier, Senator Franklin Drilon, and various groups. Obviously, there were people who were interested in being part of the senatorial slate. There were others, you know, supportive of the vice president who had their own candidates. So all these conversations took place over, you know, the course of several days, actually, since the vice president only declared last week. So it was Senator Drilon who led the conversations on the side of the vice president's team, and he talked to all these people. And the outcome was the slate that we saw earlier.
Okay, and what were the issues or criteria that you used in choosing these candidates to be included in your ticket, and what were the non-negotiables?
Well, clearly the first and most important priority was that they were actually willing to support the vice president's call. Na tama na itong ganitong klase ng pamamahala, 'di ba? Wakasan na natin ng ang pandemya at ayusin na natin ang ating bansa dahil sa kapabayaan nitong administrasyong ito. So, that particular call which he made last Thursday and under which he drew a very clear line was really the line that had to be crossed before any conversation about joining the slate could be had. And I think that it's very clear from the press conference earlier conducted by the vice president, her running mate Senator Kiko Pangilinan, and the Senate campaign manager Senator Frank Drilon, that everybody on the slate agreed with that. Everybody is supportive of VP Leni, and if she becomes president, then they will support what agenda she will set. And I think that's really the main consideration insofar as this conversation is concerned. Ito yung mga willing na pumasok dun sa pakikipag-usap, sumama nga sa lamesa, sabi nga ni VP Leni. So yun yung naging isang batayan.
So basically, she was very much involved in the selection of these people in her ticket, right?
Well, she was part of yung process, obviously, ultimately. But it was not just her decision. Si Sen Frank would lead the conversations, but as she also described earlier, may mga feedback na nakukuha from the other people who were already in the coalition. Kasi even prior to the selection process, as early as Friday last week, when she announced the candidacy of Senator Pangilinan as her vice presidential running mate, nag-announce siya ng 5 pangalan, di ba? Mm-hmm. Senator Sunny Trillanes, Senator Risa Hontiveros, Senator Laila Dilima, Attorney Chel Jokno, and Congressman Teddy Bagila. So these people bring them with them their own constituencies, their own parties, their own groups. So kasama na rin yun sa mga nakonsulta, dagdag pa dun sa mga matagal nang bahagi, di ba, nung koalisyon na sumusuporta at tumutulong kay VP Leni as, you know, leader of the opposition since years na, di ba?
Okay, and how big a factor was the candidates being quote-unquote opposition how opposition were they supposed to be able to be included?
Well, I think at this point, klaro na naman eh, di ba? Kung willing ka na i-call out yung mga pangyayari under the Duterte administration, particularly these last few months, the mismanagement of the pandemic, di ba? Yung kawalan ng direksyon sa pag-manage itong crisis na umaharap sa ating bansa, di ba? And you're really willing to say, tama na, we've had enough of this kind of governance and we need a change. Then, you know, that's the clear line that divides the opposition from people who are still supportive of the administration. In her speech last Thursday, she was very clear. Kung yung mali, na hindi mo masabing mali, di ba? Eh, nakaninong panig ka. So, ang unang requirement talaga, at I think this should be very clear to everyone, kung you're willing to come out and say, mali ito nangyayari, di ba? Kailangan baguhin ito. Diba? At wala nang quibbling, wala nang hedging na kung ano-ano pa, then that's the distinction that makes you part of the opposition.
Was it a factor that if a particular candidate who was being considered was a bit a Johnny come lately when it came to condemning all those issues that have been pervading and prevailing over the past 5 years? Kumbaga naging late opposition sila, but before that, they were somehow enablers of the current administration.
Well, you have to remember the process that the vice president went through since March, di ba? When she started talking to all these various people outside of the Duterte Marcos axis, di ba? Kung sino-sino kinausap niya, di ba? And to be perfectly honest, madami dyan, di ba? In fact, halos lahat ng ibang tumatakbo except Vice President Lenny, di ba? At one time or another, di ba, have been supportive of this administration. Medyo belated yung kanilang pag-criticize. But that's the nature of how this entire political history unfolded. May mga tao talaga na hanggat hindi nang umabot sa pandemya at naging klarong-klaro, di ba, sa mata ng lahat at sa mata ng taong bayan na itong ganitong klaseng pamumuno ng kasalukuyang administrasyon, you know, has brought us nothing but death and disease and despair and hardship, eh, hindi willing magsalita. So, she has been very upfront about that. Talagang makikipag-usap ka sa mga tao na, di ba, maaring nung nakaraan, hindi natin kahanay, pero ang importante ngayon, willing silang tumindig. That's really the point. And that doesn't just go for leaders. That also goes for supporters. Madami kaming mga nakukuha ng mga supporters, madaming mga nagpapahayag ng kanilang pagsuporta kay VP Lenny na dati, they admit, di ba? Support kami sa administrasyong ito. Di ba? Iba, nakibahagi kami sa pambabash kay VP Lenny. But hindi ba dapat tanggapin natin yon? If it comes belatedly, but it is nonetheless a clear repudiation of the kind of governance we have that we all know we cannot take another 6 years of. Why shouldn't we welcome them?
Okay, let's go specifically to Senator Richard Gordon, who was included as among the five guest candidates in your ticket. The idea that he was perceived to be very much instrumental in the persecution of the other candidate in your list, Senator Leila De Lima, was this even considered? Putting him in that ticket, but along with the person that he perceived to be to have persecuted before.
Kaya, di ba, Christian, it's fairly obvious that was considered, di ba? And the person that should have been asked is Senator Leila. And you can see that Senator Leila is actually open to supporting the inclusion of her perceived tormentor and rival, di ba, sa nakaraan. And that's really testament dun sa unifying power ni VP Lenny, di ba? That all these people who have had histories, di ba, in the past, have had their own conflicts, have had their own exchanges, are willing to come together, di ba, under the banner that she now raises, di ba? Yung banner na kailangan na nating wakasan, di ba? Itong ganitong klaseng pamumuno so that we can all move forward, di ba? Malutas yung ating crisis. That's testament to their recognition of her leadership, di ba? That's testament sa pagkilala nila na si Lenny Robredo ang kayang lumutas dito. And willing kaming iset aside kung ano man yung aming kasaysayan para suportahan yun. That's really the story here. So the story is not so much that rivals are in the same ticket. It's the story that all these people, regardless of their previous histories, are all supporting the Vice President.
Okay, but was Senator Richard Gordon even called out regarding that, or was it even raised during the negotiations or discussions?
I can't speak to the specifics of the negotiations. I was not there. Hindi ako nandun. But so, you know, I really don't know.
Okay. Now, the other question, for instance, people on social media are also raising this. For instance, the inclusion of former Vice President Jejo Marvinay in the senatorial ticket. I think there are two issues that can be raised regarding his inclusion. Again, we understand perfectly the broad coalition that is that she's trying to put together. But there are also issues hunting or trailing each of these candidates that you included, or many of them. For instance, in the case of former Vice President Jejo Marvinay, one, of course, was the issue of corruption or alleged corruption, especially during that protracted Senate investigation, which took a year, right? So never mind, even if one of his tormentors, quote-unquote, is also included in your ticket, Senator Antonio Trillanes. But was that even a factor? The impression of corruption. And of course, number two, yung political dynasty. Uupo siya sa Senado kung sakali manalo, dalawa sila ng anak niya.
Okay. Again, I will make very clear, diba? We are in a crisis, diba? We are in a state where we cannot actually quibble because another 6 years of this kind of governance will really lead us nowhere, diba? Hindi natin alam kung saan tayo pupulutin after that. And that has been the clarion call, the rallying cry that the Vice President delivered last Thursday. So, the principal objective, really, bring together as broad a coalition as possible, di ba? Yung makakatulong sa ating makapagpanalo ng isang ticket na mapapalitan yung ganitong klaseng pamumuno, di ba? At maayos yung ating landas, di ba? Masosolve itong crisis na ito, di ba? So, alam mo naman eh, di ba? In politics, everybody will have a history, di ba? There will be rivalries, there will be allegations, there will be kung ano-anong mga bagahe dala ng iba't iba. Sabi nga ni VP Lenny kanina umaga, wala namang perfecto sa atin, di ba? So, you know, and I'm not dismissing yung mga ganitong klaseng mga bagay, di ba? I'm sure that at the appropriate time, di ba, there will be enough people interested enough to raise this with these personalities directly. But what is important right now is these are the people who have come together and expressed their willingness to share the Vice President's perspective on where we are. They are the ones who have come together to express their support for her leadership, their belief na siya talaga yung makakaahon sa atin sa ganitong klaseng crisis at ganitong klaseng problema. So that's what we're focusing on. Kasi walang katapusan yan eh. If we're going to actually keep going back at magsingilan tayo, klaro naman eh, we have been on opposite sides. Sabi nga ni Senator Kiko kanina, I mean, oh, you know, part of democracy is learning to work with those you dislike. That's it. That's the nature of a coalition. That's the nature of calling for unity. Talagang ang makakasama mo lang, hindi yung mga dati mo nang nakagawi ang kasama. That goes at the level of leadership, yung mga personalities at yung mga kandidato. That also goes down to the level ng mga makakatrabaho mo on the ground, the volunteers. And okay. In an election, in a campaign, you can't afford to be so insistent na, eh, but ito ginawa nyo dati, sinabi mo to dati, therefore, di ba, I will hold it against you forever. That can't be the case. We have to, sinabi nga niya, we have to go beyond yung ating mga echo chambers. We have to expand our ranks. And that's precisely what we are attempting to do here. We're not saying, kalimutan na lahat yan, but there will be a time and place for that. Right now, the focus is itong pandemya, pagbabalik ng maayos na gobyerno, and that's what we're focusing on.
Okay. The other question, of course, other people perhaps see this as an egregious oversight or slight even on the part of one politician. The question is, how come you're willing to accept the likes of, let's say, Senator Gordon, given his history with Laila De Lima, and of course, former Vice President Jejo Marvinay, but you could not include someone like former Bayan Muna Representative Nery Colmenares, who was in fact part of the Isang Bayan process in this ticket. What happened there?
Kaguhin ko muna yung sa sinabi mo. Ha? Para kasi pag sinabi mong, how come you accepted? Diba? It was not one person. It was not the Vice President herself lang. Yeah. It was not the team lang. Yeah. Remember, ang biggest axe to grind kay sa mga ibang taon to are people on the slate. Senator De Lima, Senator Trillanes. Yeah. And if they are willing to work with these personalities, diba, parang shouldn't that be an indicator of how much importance we should be placing on these previous histories and these previous rivalries. But setting that aside and focusing on the question of Nery. Well, one, there's a 12 slot. At sinabi naman very clearly ni Vice President kanina that Congressman Colmenares, who was with us in Congress before, is still someone who is being considered to fill that 12th slot, along with several other people. She made it very clear she wants the 12th slot to be filled by somebody who has worked with and is representing a marginalized sector. So women, labor, farmers, etc. So obviously, Congressman Colmenares, fits that particular description. He's still very much one of the people whose name is being considered for inclusion. So hindi pa tapos siya at hindi pa sarado yung prosesong yan.
Okay, but again, help us understand why he was not yet included. Was it because of Congressman Colmenares and his Makabayan Block, or was the reason in the side of Robredo Group? Bakit hindi pa siya nakasama?
Let's put it this way, 'di ba? Sa isang koalisyon, 'di ba? Madaming boses na kailangang pakinggan, 'di ba? Madaming boses na bahagi nung nagiging proseso. And you know, there were people in the coalition who have expressed some reservations about Makabayan, about working with Makabayan, about their past history. And you know, that has to be considered in the process. But as I said, hindi sarado yung desisyon, hindi pa tapos itong prosesong ito. It is an ongoing process. And definitely, whatever decision comes out, we'll have to take into account the perspectives and the opinions and the feelings of all those who are already in the coalition and who have already committed themselves to supporting the Vice President's presidential run.
Okay, correct me if I'm wrong, but the initial impression that I'm getting is that these voices of opposition are so strong that you could not accommodate Congressman Colmenares yet at this stage. But those that were opposing the likes of, for example, Gordon or Binay, they were not too serious to exclude them at this stage. Is that correct?
Well, you have to remember that it's not just that concerns are raised about him personally, but that there are other people being considered for the same slot. Diba? Nabanggit kanina umaga, si Sunny Matula. Diba? Yeah. Binanggit ni VP Lenny kanina, there were about four or five names na being considered. So it's not so much the opposition to one person, diba? At yun lang ang naging determining factor. It's also the fact that there are other names being considered. Yun nga yung naging problema, sabi ni Senator Drilon kanina, di ba? Ang daming gustong maging bahagi ng slate ni VP Lenny at ni Senator Kiko. So really, part of the challenge was really prioritizing sino yung pwedeng makapasok. And it just so happened na si Kong Nery, who is still in consideration, let me underscore that very clearly, hindi pa napapag-desisyonan yung kanyang pagiging kandidato sa slate na ito.
Okay, who was among those who opposed his inclusion? Was it former Senator Antonio Trillanes?
Ayoko nang sagutin yan, di ba? I don't want to go into the specifics of who said what, di ba? Who said this. After all, di ba? This is one of the reasons why we are so insistent on not talking about the details of pag-uusap is, di ba? Ayaw namin makadagdag pa yan doon sa... Well, the process itself is hard enough, di ba? Talking to all these people, talking to all these forces, talking to all these persuasions. Ayoko nang dagdagan pa yon na in addition sa pag-uusap person to person, magkakaroon pa tayo ng intrigahan sa labas. So, you know, huwag na natin ano yun yung detalye. Rest assured lang that it's ongoing and the people that need to be talked to are being talked to.
Okay, did Vice President Lenny Robredo actually reach out to the left? In particular, the National Democrats, yung NDs.
Madami mga conversations that have happened all throughout the years. Are you specifically asking about since she actually became a candidate?
Yeah.
There was a meeting on Friday last week after she and Senator Kiko Pangilinan declared Isambayan came to visit them. And I know that Makabayan is part of Isambayan and the representative, if I'm not mistaken, si Congressman Tino was there.
Okay. Now let's talk about the other possible reason. Mamaya tatanungin natin because after this interview, we will have former Congressman Nery Colmenares. Was it also the reason? Was this part of the reason or was this a factor? The fact that after the Isambayan process was completed and that the coalition endorsed Vice President Lenny Robredo for president, the Makabayan Bloc, despite welcoming that endorsement, has not yet actually thrown its support behind the choice of Isambayan. Was that a factor?
Well, you know, that's really a question you should ask si my friend Neri. Insofar as we're concerned, okay, si Vice President hindi may personal yan. So I very much doubt that for her that was a factor.
Okay, but pero what do you think of that idea in the first place? The idea that the Makabayan Bloc was included in the Isambayan process, but after the process was completed and Robredo was endorsed already for president, Makabayan Bloc as part of Isambayan did not or has not yet thrown its support behind that endorsement.
Well, I'm not privy to kung ano yung process ng Isambayan, so I wouldn't know what their procedures are for this. But I would imagine that in any democratic agrupation, di ba, every individual participant is entitled to express their opinion. They express their opinion, so they're entitled to that. Honestly, we are not really that focused on whatever happens sa Isambayan. What is key for us is they endorsed the vice president as an organization, as a collective, and she was very appreciative of it. Makabayan came up with its separate position, and you know, gaya ng sabi ko, that's on them. You might want to ask them kung what they intended by it. But what should be clear is, if you're implying that had anything to do with parang yung hesitation or yung pagtagal nitong prosesong ito, I don't think so. That's such a minor thing, I think, compared to everything else that we have to grapple with. Kung yung mga ibang mga talagang lantarang kaharap sa kalaban sa politika before na welcome into the group, paano pa kaya yung yan lang yung issue?
Actually, I was not just implying. I was actually asking it directly. Kasi some people might even...
Hindi ganun si BP Lady. Definitely.
Hindi kasi that might be logical for some to think, di ba? Na why would I include you in my list when you don't even want to support me, my candidacy at this stage? Di ba?
Yeah, but to a certain extent, it seems, I don't know, ako, ito is, I have to admit this. The last week, we have been... I have been asked so many questions about, di ba kayo nainis kasi sinabi ni ganito to? Di ba? O ganito. It seems so petty. Di ba? Yun yung point ko eh. And I don't think that we can afford pettiness, di ba, at this point. And definitely, pettiness is the last adjective you can apply to the vice president. She is very clear on what the priorities are at this point. She is very clear on what needs to be done. And yung ganong parang... medyo minor na slight, hindi kami sumuporta agad. I don't think that will play any role whatsoever. It will be given, I don't think it will be given any weight whatsoever in the very, very important decision na ginagawa natin dito.
Okay, that's a petty issue in short.
Yes.
Okay. Now, what do you expect of this from this guest candidates? For instance, ano yung requirements before they were included? Can they also endorse other presidential candidates? Because
ang clear ni Senator Drilon kanina, the minimum ask of yung mga guest candidates is that they don't endorse anybody else. Yun yung punto. He made that clear in the press conference.
What if they end up endorsing, let's say, one or two candidates?
Well, I suppose we have to cross that bridge when we get there. Diba? And I will leave that to the Senate slate campaign manager to resolve.
But was that?
Kasi I don't want to speculate, 'di ba? Hindi ko din alam. 'Di ba? And it's not my call, it's not my decision, and I don't want to preempt si Senator Drilon.
But would you know whether that was part of the conversation before they were included as guest candidates?
What I do know is that he said that was the minimum ask. So I assume that it was part of the conversation. I was not there, diba? But he made it very clear kanina that the minimum ask of the guest candidates is that you do not endorse anybody else. Obviously, if they endorse the vice president, si BP Lenny for president, that's great. that's the ideal. But minimum, diba, if you're not going to endorse the vice president directly, then don't endorse anybody else. Yun yung clear niya kanina.
Openly? Or even surreptitiously?
Mas mahirap na usap yun, di ba? And you know, ayoko na mag-speculate kung ano yan dahil una-una, how do you prove that? Ano yung
sample
indicator
ballot
na may surreptitious, di ba?
Sample ballot.
We'll see later on. I don't want to cross that bridge before we get there. And as I said, hindi ko ambit yan, so I can't comment on it.
Okay. And also help us understand the process at Isambayan and the selection process by the vice president. were they exactly parallel to each other? Because there was the impression that the vice president was very much involved in the Isambayan process itself, right?
Hindi. Definitely not. She was not involved at all. Diba? Parang Isambayan was its own independent process composed by the groups that were members of Isambayan. Si VP Leni was never a part of it, except to the extent that she agreed to be one of the nominees up for consideration ng Isambayan. And then the next part na was when they endorsed her and she eventually ran, diba? And welcomed the endorsement of Isambayan. But as to being part of that process, na yung decision making, yung naging mga consultations sila among their members, VP Leni had no hand in that at all. She was pursuing her own initiative to actually talk to other people who could potentially be allies and members of a coalition going into 2022. And that was a separate and distinct effort from the effort pursued by Isambayan. Because you have to remember, madami doon sa kinausap ni VP Leni weren't even part of the Isambayan process.
Okay. And finally, Attorney Barry, is the Vice President and his and her team still looking for a possible tie-up or joining of forces, let's say, with the group of Senator Manny Pacquiao and perhaps replace Vice Presidential candidate Kiko Pangilinan with Senator Pacquiao?
She's made that very clear that right now, tapos na yung unity talks for the moment, di ba? Naka-focus na tayong lahat doon sa kampanya. Naka-focus na lahat tayo sa ipapanalo yung eleksyon for Leni Robredo as president and Kiko Pangilinan as vice president. So that's where the focus is. Of course, di ba? She won't say no kung may magusto makipag-usap, but again, hindi na yan yung priority. So ibig sabihin, we will be there, willing to talk, but the priority is now moving forward to 2022 to ensure the continued expansion of support for our two standard bearers, VP Leni and Senator Kiko.
So she will stick it out with the vice presidential candidate Pangilinan.
I think that's pretty clear from their pronouncements over the past week.
Okay. Attorney Barry Gutierrez, thank you for joining us tonight. And thank you for answering our questions.
Anytime, Christian. It's always an interesting time being here.
Okay. We're taking a short break. After the fact, we'll be right back. Welcome back to After the Fact. The hashtag #WeWantNeri trends on Twitter Philippines after Vice President Leni Robredo unveiled the list of senatorial aspirants that she will support in 2022. Some social media users are using the hashtag to express their disappointment following her decision to leave out from the slate former Bayan Muna Party List Representative Neri Colmenares. Others are also making a case for why Colmenares should be included in the roster. Joining us tonight is the senatorial aspirant himself, former congressman and attorney, Neri Colmenares. Good evening, sir, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Good evening, Christian, and good evening po sa lahat ng viewers po ninyo.
Okay, let's start with that basic question. People are asking, why were you left out as far as you know? Why were you not included in the senatorial slate at this stage by Vice President Leni Robredo?
I wouldn't know really, Christian, no? Kasi they have their own process. They have their own political party. So they went through, I'm sure, a consultation, convention, or an assembly. And that, of course, takes precedence. As my statement naman kanina, is the prerogative of the vice president. Kasi recognize naman natin that the presidential candidate, medyo may free hand ka talaga to select your senatorial slate. So I've always told friends within them. Sabi ko, I don't have any rancor. I understand that. I mean, she felt it was best for her candidacy, so that's her prerogative. So, and I respect that right, Christian naman, of the presidential bet to select her senatorial candidate. So I wouldn't really know kung anong reason. It's just the fact that she did say na hindi ako kasama, but there is a 12th slot na posible. Saan nabanggit niya doon kanina.
But is she or any member of her team actually in touch with you for your possible inclusion?
Well, we wanted to discuss with the Vice President, of course, the issues of platform for quite some time. And people's issues kasi very important sa mga kabayan yan. Discuss kung ano yung issues ng mamamayan, like contractualization, free distribution of land, you know, the usual issues of mga kabayan. We never got the chance. However, yes, there were some representatives of the Vice President who called me up to discuss that I'm being considered. However, there were objections within their slate or coalition. So
were you told, and would you know who this oppositor was, the one who opposed your inclusion?
Yes, well, nabanggit yan. It's Senator Trillanes ang nabanggit, no? So yes, and we would have been happy if we could have sat down with the Vice President so that they could discuss with us not just the platform but also the concerns or objections in full, so that we can respond naman, no? Pero we never had the chance. But yes, there, of course, a presidential campaign will, I'm sure, will talk to organizations like Makabayan, because I think naman may recognition naman syempre that Makabayan is an opposition and we have our own people and we have our, you know, sabi ko nga, we have our base of voters naman, we have the national machinery naman for campaign, we have the national machinery naman for poll watching. So we're glad na may pag-uusap naman with the representatives, but ang hinihingi sana namin is Makabayan could sit down with the Vice President and discuss their platform, kasi very important sa amin yan. It's not merely an issue of being the slate kasi Christian. Being in the slate, parang yes, it's very welcome kung sakaling masama ka sa slate, but it's not merely a question of what's in it for me. Diba? So, ang sunod kasi na importanteng question ng Makabayan, what is in it for the marginalized and the poor sectors? Issue ito ng platform and people's issues. So, anong position sa mga katulad na nabanggit ko, like
contractualization? Pero so bago po natin himayin yung ano, yung non-inclusion ninyo, this is late na. Let's talk about the efforts. Was there really an effort on the part of the Vice President to reach out to the left, to your group, to the Makabayan Bloc, during those unity talks?
Well, we reached out to her for quite some time now, actually. And the last, I think, was during the wake of President Aquino. I was there together with Congressman Tino, and we met the Vice President. And of course, we extended our condolences and sympathies to the family, kila Chris, no? And so we raised it again. VP, we're trying to, you know, meet with you and discuss. Tatakbo ka ba o hindi? But other than that, anong tingin mo sa mga platforms, etc.? Because for a long time, di naman siya nag-announce kung tatakbo siya. So sabi niya, yes, I'd like to talk with you. So hindi natuloy-tuloy yun eh. So, but yun nga, representatives niya ang tumatawag sa amin. So, except na ang hinahanap sana namin, if we can also, of course, discuss with her personally rin, sa issues ng platform. Kasi from her public pronouncements, Christian, her platform seems good, no? From her public pronouncement. Pero syempre, iba talaga yung formal talks at formal din na laman ng platform niya. Makabayan has its own platform, eh. Hindi naman kami nag-expect that she or any presidential candidate will unify naman sa lahat ng... But at least we can find the commonalities para naman we can tell our members na ito, among members kasi namin, Christian, are farmers, are workers, urban poor. We can tell them, she's okay, he is okay, or whoever, with workers' issues or farmers' issues. So we would have wanted that sana. And because she announced naman that there's a 12th slot and their ongoing talk, so we're hoping na at least magkakaroon ng ganung pagkakataon para ma-inform namin siya ng platform namin. And of course, we can also get from her what her platform is on various issues namin sa Makabayan itself, no, among our constituencies.
Okay. Regarding the person who opposed your, or supposedly opposed your inclusion in the slate, he said it was former Senator Antonio Trillanes. But as relayed to you, what were the reasons for that opposition?
Well, ang nabanggit ng representative, parang, well, you know, red tagging. So, at pangalawa, links with Isko Moreno. So, ang sagot ko naman sa representative, alam mo yung red tagging. I don't probably need to answer that. We've answered that so many times. Yung representative mismo, sabi ko na red tag ka, di ba? Sabi niya, oo nga, of all people, ako pa na red tag. So sabi ko, di ba si Senator Aquino was convicted of death penalty ng panahon ng martial law because together with Joe Masiso and Dante. That's the acme of red tagging, sabi ko. I don't need to answer that. Yung links with Isko, so sinabi ko naman dun sa representative na wala kaming makabayan, has no decision, has no links, has no decision na mag-suporta. So of course, Isko, sabi ko, di nakasama ko yan sa senatorial noong 2016. But to imply that we have already decided, I don't see the basis for that, except according to Senator Trillanes. I saw your ano kasi interview. Sinabi niya, according to my information, so medyo may problema pag according to my information. And it reminds me of President Duterte, who used to make decisions according to information, di ba? According to Intel report, may list siya ng mga kung ano-ano. So I think, yes, but medyo nadismaya lang ako that the senatorial slate of the opposition will say these intrigues ba and lies against fellow opposition candidate, di ba? So siguro naman, Christian, hindi naman matatawaran na opposition din kami. Marami na sa amin ang namatay, marami sa amin na kulong. Probably other political parties like Senator Trillanes, may patay din sila o may nakulong. But then, kasi sinasabi ko lang naman, marami naman sa amin na pinatay na under Duterte. So tingin ko naman, klaro na opposition kami. So we hope na ang unification ng opposition will still be the pursuit of all, katulad ni Senator Trillanes, para naman at least makalaban tayo ng husto, okay, to defeat the Marcoses and the Dutertes.
Okay. Since we're in the topic of Senator Antonio Trillanes, tanongin ko na rin kayo dun sa ibang portions pa ng mga sinabi niya, di ba? You already answered, okay, yung sinabi ni Senator Trillanes na based on his information, itong makabayan block nando na kay Isko, kaya nahihirapan sila mag-out ngayon, okay? But the other portion of that lengthy interview also, he also touched on your history in 2010 and of course in 2016. Una yung sinabi niya, in 2010, you supported the presidential candidacy of then Senator Manny Villar. You were even in the same stage with Bongbong Marcos. Then of course, ang isang issue na ibinabato, not just by Senator Trillanes, but other critics of your organization, yung sinasabi na at the start of the Duterte administration, you were considered as enablers, di ba? Because certain members of your group or actually joined his cabinet. And again, alam ko sinagot nyo na to in previous discussions, but I think
yes,
it's also important to raise this still again, di ba? Yung belated condemnation nyo raw ng extrajudicial killings or alleged extrajudicial killings or in drug-related killings.
Yes. I'm the chairman of NUPL. As early as July 4 of 2016, and that can be borne out dyan sa the statement ng NUPL, we already expressed concern doon sa extrajudicial killings. Barely 4 days naman si Duterte doon. And Makabayan filed a resolution to investigate the extrajudicial killings as early as August of 2016. Barely 2 months pa lang si Duterte sa ano. I don't know if there are other political parties who filed similar resolution. I mean, there probably was, no? But at least that also proves na kami naman sa Makabayan, kung may sinasabi ka, may pinangako ka na maganda sa mamamayan, o hindi talaga man naman, of course, welcome, di ba? Pero pag may ginagawa ka namang tingin namin mali, we will not have any problem condemning. So, ganun. And I think that's the best for a legislator. The best position of a legislator is hindi yung kongresista na kung sino ang presidente, lumilipat doon sa bagong paupo na presidente, magbabalimbing na. Kundi isang legislator na who will support what is good but who will also criticize what is bad. So, that's what we did. And the extrajudicial killings, I'd like to be clear, we have always condemned that, and as sabi ko nga, as early as August of 2016, and the records of the House of Representatives will bear that out. We already issued a resolution to investigate extrajudicial killings. Of course, it did not gather any support. And we would have wanted many other co-authors there. That's, you know, ganun talaga ang buhay because may supermajority.
About the idea that some of your colleagues who were part of the cabinet stuck it out with the president despite those supposed non-negotiable issues. For example, the thousands killed during the drug war. Why did it take time for them to leave or had to wait, some of them, before the CA rejected their appointments?
Yes, well, actually, yung pag-raise kay President Duterte ng issue ng extrajudicial killings have been raised all throughout, even by the cabinet members. So ang ano lang doon, of course, may mga pangako siya. He promised free distribution of lands to farmers. Can you imagine that, Christian? Pangako ang presidente. Yeah, but the fact that he mentioned it, alam mo, when he ran for the presidency, ang sabi ko noon, nang may campaigning ng mga drugs, mga ganito, contract. Sabi ko, contractualization, oh, trap lang yan, nangangako lang yan. But when he sat in power in Malacanang, and he repeated it, ha? He repeated na labanan ko ang contractualization. I mean, he doesn't even need to say that kasi panalo na siya eh. But he repeated it. So really, that's something that every worker or farmer should support, right? And we just represented that sentiment among our constituents na manggagawa at magsasaka na, uy, tatanggalin ang contractualization. Of course, he did not fulfill it in the end. In fact, vinito niya pa nga yung contractualization bill. But during that time, so sa amin, very ano yan, very important din na mailaban yung mga constituency demands namin without, of course, reneging on that commitment naman sa issue ng human rights. And we've always, in a principled manner, maintained that with President Duterte by raising to him and criticizing him for the extrajudicial killings.
Okay. Earlier you said you haven't had any opportunity or chance to actually sit down face-to-face with Vice President Lenny Robredo to talk about platform, right? How about with other candidates? For example, have you done that with Senator Manny Pacquiao and Mayor Isko Moreno?
Yes. Well, actually, lahat ng presidential, sabi ko, campaigns, mag-usap naman with makabayan. We've talked with them, with the presidential balls, Mayor Isko and Senator Manny Pacquiao, before Lenny Robredo announced her filing of candidacy on October 7. For a long time, we don't even know if President Lenny will run, but she continued to espouse unity among the opposition candidates or those candidates na lumalaban kay President Duterte. So yes, we discussed platforms and we discussed issues. Anong tingin mo sa mga bagay-bagay? And I don't think there's any problem there. In fact, Vice President Lenny Robredo also did that, right? She talked with Isko Moreno and Manny Pacquiao and probably others also. Okay. Because of her search for a unified opposition, which we also faithfully followed among ourselves. She espoused unification of the opposition and we agree with her. In fact, mas pare-pareho nga kami ng sentiments noon na yun ang best na gagawin sana natin to ensure the defeat of the Dutertes and the Marcosets in their attempt to go back to Malacanang.
Okay, so na-presenta niya na yung plataforma niyo kay Isko Moreno at saka kay Manny Pacquiao, no? Even before Lenny Robredo declared her candidacy.
Okay. Before that.
She declared. Okay. So between Isko Moreno and Manny Pacquiao, whose platform has more congruence with yours?
Well, we haven't seen their written platforms also, but they have given us an idea on what their platform is. Pagkausap mo si Senator Manny, he has more unities with us in terms of platform because he's very open doon sa mga issues na endo, na ganun, very open siya doon. And in fact, even sa minimum wage, very open siya doon. So, at syempre, housing para sa mga urban poor, etc. So may mga ganyan na mga ano, pero hindi pa rin sana makakita kami talaga ng mga concrete na, you know, black and white na platform, but based on their discussions may mga pagkakaisa naman sa ilang platforma. Although, of course, hindi naman lahat na platforma.
How about with the Manila Mayor Isko Moreno? Ano yung mga sticking points, for instance?
Yes, well, he was very, very supportive naman sa maraming platform. Of course, may ilan siyang hindi maibigay agad. So that's the part of his decision din, syempre. And we cannot force him to, basta may commonalities sa mga platforms.
Like what? Ano yung basic difference, for instance? Ano ba yung land distribution?
Yes. Well, hindi niya ni-raise yung land distribution during the talks. I don't know. Kasi ang narinig ko dati sa isang speech niya sa isang forum, parang, you know, he's trying to learn from the farmers pa. Kasi city boy siya. Yeah. So, ang kuha ko doon, he's probably saying na, aralin ko yan kasi hindi naman ako rural boy. So, probably that's the reason. I don't know. But he did not raise that as a unified na perception sa amin.
Okay. At this stage, why hasn't Makabayan, the Makabayan Bloc chosen anyone to support for president? What are you waiting for?
Yes. Well, actually, yung issue ng platform. Sabi ko nga kanina, it's not merely an issue of kasama ka sa slate. That's very welcome, of course. If I am included, di ba, syempre, okay yon. But kailangan din kasi yung platform eh. Kasi for me, di, siguro, kung nakuha na ako sa platform, di okay na, wala na tayong pag-usapan. Pero we represent kasi a constituency, the farmers, the workers, sinabi ko na kanina. At hindi kami pwedeng pumunta sa kanila na, uy, suportahan nyo to. Ano bang ano para sa land reform? Ano ba yung kanyang sa contractualization? We will not be able to answer that. Very crucial sa amin yon.
Okay.
And Makabayan has always done that. Presidential candidate.
Okay, so you need to speak with the vice president first, face to face.
Sana.
Okay. And then after that, you're going to make your decision. Kasi nakausap niya na yung dalawa.
Yes.
Are you even talking with... I suppose you're not talking with Bongbong, right?
No. Definitely.
And Ting Lakson.
No.
Lina, so yung tatlo lang talaga pinagpipilian niya, di ba?
Yes. So, yeah, okay. And I announced na kanina na ongoing talks at possibly... we're expecting and hoping naman na matuloy na yung pag-uusap with her. Kasi, yun na nga... it will really speed up our decision if we also get to learn from her platform. Although, gusto kong ulitin, Christian, from her public pronouncements, mukhang marami siyang agreement sa amin din. Kasi yung sa issue ng accountability, for example, sa ICC, sa human rights violations, sa corruption. So mukhang marami rin siyang mga agreements with us.
Okay. I'd also like to ask this very straightforward question. Hindi naman kaya saddled kayo ng issue na baka you're not yet throwing your support behind a particular candidate, let's say Rene Robredo, because you're looking for someone who you think would have the best chance of winning in 2022.
Well, actually, yun ang issue, yun ang gusto ng Makabayan at ni Vice President Rene Robredo also, na mag-unify ang opposition doon sa may best chance to defeat, di ba? Is that still there? Yes, of course. Medyo ano na ngayon kasi nagsasagutan na yung mga presidential candidates ng opposition. Medyo may kahirapan na yun. But that's still a good principle. But the very reason talaga yung Christian, why we haven't, haven't selected yet, kasi may process pa ng katulad ng sinabi ni VP kanina, may ongoing talks pa on that. Very important ulit sa amin yon. For us to sell a candidate to our members, we need to tell them, ano ba ang sa masa?
Okay.
Ano ba yung para sa inyo?
Okay, finally, so, before we end, very briefly, yes. I'd like to read the question directed to you. As a final point, no? Final word na rin. Are you not too fixated on platforms after Duterte? Do you still put a premium on them instead of character and track record?
What Duterte did was really, really horrible. Bigla niyang winala yung issue ng platform. And we want to change that. We want to hold presidential candidates accountable for their pronouncements. So the fact that Duterte destroyed that doesn't mean we are going to allow it to the next presidential candidates. Otherwise, wala talagang basis ang tao pumili, di ba? Why should you even choose this? Kasi guwapo siya or gusto. Diba? So for us, dapat ibalik yun. No, I don't think we're fixated. And I think our hindi lang constituents namin, but the Filipino people are also looking for that in the candidates themselves, di ba?
Okay.
So very important sa amin. It's not even a question of who will best win, kundi who has the most to deliver for the benefit of the Filipino people.
Okay. Attorney Nery Colmenares, thank you for joining us tonight, sir.
Maraming salamat din po, Christian. Good evening po.
Good evening. So that's it for tonight. This has been your host, Christian Esquera. You can watch this episode again on iWantTFC or listen to our podcast on Spotify. Now for recaps and other exclusive content, subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel and catch up with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. See you again on Monday after the fact.